Restrictions are easing and life is returning to a new normal. Over the lockdown, we've been decluttering our houses and doing a whole lot of cosmetic change, but now we're starting to think about the deeper life changes. What are we taking out of this time? Join with us as we explore on a series called The Roadmap to Renewal, Deeper, Meaningful Life Change. Hi, and thanks for joining us at Reedy Creek Baptist Church's online services. And Dave, you're looking pretty fresh from a couple of days off.
Yeah, it was nice. Last weekend, Leslie and I went to Kingaroy.
Sounds fantastic. And apparently you went to an observatory.
Yes, we did actually. I've never been to an observatory, but it was great. You know, it was pitch dark at night time out there in the country, and the scene was just beautiful up
there. Yeah, I bet it was great. I bet it was real good fun. Hey, thanks for filling out the online surveys. We've come to realise that 2 a.m. services are going to work starting on the 19th of January. We're going to have an 8 a.m. service and a 9:30 a.m. service where the children's programs will be running. But the 5 o'clock service, David?
No, we didn't have enough interest in the 5 p.m. service. So thanks to those who said that they would like to go to that service. But we just really did not have enough interest in that service. We still got interest, though, with the house church concept. And please come and have a chat to us if you want to know a little bit more information about it. But I'm excited about the 8 a.m. and the 9:30 service, that we're finally coming back together on the 19th of July. It's going to be a lovely time together. We're going to give you some little bit more information as we get closer to it, what to expect and so on. But it's going to be a great launch on the 19th of July, 8 a.m. and 9:30.
Yeah, and another thing for your diary as well, on the 12th of July, the Sunday preceding that, we'll be having finishing up a day of prayer and fasting, which I'm looking forward to. I think it's a really good way to start this new season.
Yeah, look, we are entering into a new season, and it's just a great way in which we can come together before God and just give thanks to Him and pray for this next season. And the next season, I'm excited about the next season. There's some new things that are happening in the life of our church, and we just want to commit those things to God in prayer, but also thank God for helping us through this past season that we've been through. Robbie, all the very best. I know you're about to head off. We're recording this on Wednesday, but tomorrow you're heading off for your annual holidays. I hope you have a wonderful time, and thanks for your ministry with us over this period of time as well. Thank you so much for joining with us today, and enjoy this beautiful song.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you, only you. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. And all the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. Oh, it's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise, pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only.
This morning we've asked Heidi to come and pray for us and with us. But before she does, just want to ask Heidi a couple of questions. So good morning, Heidi. Good to have
you
with us.
Nice to be here.
Just want to ask you a couple of questions. You have a role up at Hillcrest. What is that?
That's right. So I'm one of the junior school chaplains up there. Yeah. So I work at Hillcrest 2.5 days a week.
And what's your role there as a chaplain? What do you do?
So I help to coordinate the chapels, particularly this year for the little ones, so the prep to twos.
So before we go today, I wanted to share with you a Bible verse that tells us how Jesus is our perfect example of serving others. And it's from Mark chapter 10, verse 45. In the same way, Jesus did not come to be served. He came to serve. Jesus came to give his life to save many people. Prep to twos, let's close our eyes and bow our heads and pray with me. Lord Jesus,
we thank you. And also help to provide pastoral care, one-on-one and in groups as well.
Talking about pastoral care, how has term two been a weird term, but what does that mean in terms of pastoral care as a chaplain?
So we have seen probably an increase in kids who are a bit more anxious about coming back to school after the lockdown time.
Yeah.
So that can be around things like simple things like missing their family, particularly for the younger kids, or finding that friendship groups have changed a little bit over that time, or just getting used to being in the school environment again every day.
Yeah, for sure. Well, thank you for your ministry up there at Hillcrest, and thanks for leading us in a word of prayer. Let's
pray.
No
worries.
Our loving Father, we thank you for your love and kindness that you extend to us each day. We praise you for your awesome creation, and we thank you for the stunning beauty that surrounds us here on the Gold Coast. Please help us to take time out to enjoy all the beauty that you've provided with us, and to appreciate your glory reflected so wonderfully in the things that you have made. Lord, we look forward to July 19, when we can finally meet together as a physical church body again after so long. We pray that we can quickly re-establish a genuine connection with one another, and that we will be enabled to care for each other in an even deeper way than before. We pray that you will guide leaders at all levels of our church as they make decisions regarding safe and fruitful ways of meeting together, both on Sundays and during the week. We thank you for the new youth initiatives which are planned for Friday nights from mid-July. Please help our young people to experience a place of acceptance, connection, and spiritual growth here at Reedy. We pray that you will give Robbie wisdom guidance and grace as he coordinates this program. We also thank you for Andrew's legacy in the lives of our young people. We pray that you'll be with the whole Reneker family as Andrew adjusts to his new role as a social worker. Lord, we want to thank you for all the teachers and support workers who have worked so hard and risen to the significant challenge of providing online learning to our schools over this past term. We pray that these school holidays will be a time of rest and rejuvenation for both teachers and students following a very unique and challenging term. Father, we also think of those who are unwell or who are grieving loved ones today. Please be with Kazuko, Tony and Barris, Noel Simpson, Shirley Cook, Elaine Flett, Mark Treble, and Janelle Fraser's family. Lord, we rejoice with Lynn Turner that she is able to return to her prison chaplaincy role this week. We thank you for the hope, light, and love that she brings into the women's lives, and we pray that she will quickly be able to establish meaningful connections, both new and old. Lord, we want to pray at this tumultuous time that you will bring healing and justice to the oppressed across our globe. We think of Indigenous peoples worldwide who have endured centuries of discrimination, disadvantage, and oppression. And we pray for leaders who will acknowledge the depth of these hurts and begin to make real steps towards true justice and a fair playing field for all. Father, please be with those of us who have been affected more than most by the COVID-19 pandemic. We think of those who have lost their jobs or had hours cut, and those vulnerable people or families who have been particularly susceptible to acute isolation. Please draw them especially close to you and provide them with all their needs each day. Lord, we thank you that we are never without your presence, your grace, and your forgiveness. Help us to know and experience your love more deeply and enable us to show the love and grace of Jesus towards everyone we encounter this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Today we got the privilege of getting to know Bill and Kim Horn a bit better. Good morning.
Good morning.
Yeah, good to
morning,
have you both here, and thanks very much for all that you do around the church. Tell us a little bit about your working history.
Well, for me, I left home at 16 to join the army and do an apprenticeship, and after doing officer training, 20 years later I left the army. We were living in Canberra, so we stayed there for another more than 20 years, and I did time in the corporate private sector. And then when we left Canberra, we came up here, and my current job, which I'm about to leave, is a business manager at one of the schools at Griffith University.
Very good. 16, you signed up. That's a young age. How did your parents feel about that?
Mum wasn't very happy, but it was the best option.
Yeah, good on you. And for you, Kim?
Well, a couple of years out of school in Sydney, I joined the Army as well, and that's where I met Bill, of course. And then after 10 years, was able to be a stay-at-home mum when I had my first child. We had our first child. And during that time, I did some study at Canberra Uni, in got a sports degree, and lucked in by getting a job at the Australian Institute of Sport. So I was there for 14 years, and then when we moved up here, was able to also get a job at Griffith University, and quite independent of Bill, so that was fabulous, actually.
Yeah, that is great. And you just made mention, you've got two boys?
Yes, we do. Two married sons. One lives in Brisbane, one lives, well, now in Albury. The eldest one works in the arts industry, so that's a bit of a tough gig at the moment, and the youngest one is in the Army.
Yeah, and he's stationed at the moment?
In Albury, Wodonga.
Yeah. Tell us about your faith journeys.
Well, I think for me, I was raised in a Christian home, but when I joined the Army, I think for that I wasn't very mature and I drifted away. Ended up with a very tough personal situation. The good thing about that is it brought me back to the Lord, and since then my faith has just been increasing all the time. Kim and I have been married for 35 years, and we know that we wrap our marriage around the Lord, and He just blesses our marriage all the time.
Yeah, that's great.
Unlike Bill, I was brought up in a non-Christian family, a loving, caring, fun-filled, quintessential, I guess, Aussie family in Sydney. And I came to the Lord a couple of months after we married, and through Bill, so I'm just incredibly blessed and thankful that the Lord brought us together. For me, as well as endorsing what Bill said about our marriage being foundationally based on the Lord and Christianity, for me, I am very keen to make sure that I'm sincere in my faith. And for me, that means being open and honest about my sin and my weaknesses as a Christian, but also my motivation when I'm doing anything. I just try and make sure that it's from a servant heart or a Christian heart, and I just call that sincerity of faith. So that's where I'm at.
You both are either are or just about to enter into a new season of your life. What is that new season, and what will a new normal look like for you two, if you can answer that?
So that's a very interesting question. I have just retired from paid work, and that was a little bit unplanned. And so is, in fact, Bill going to retire. That was planned. So, so again, we weren't planning to retire within 6 or 7 weeks of each other, but that's the Lord's plan, and we accept that. So it's just a matter of pivoting from paid work into our community work. And for me, that means, well, an extension of what I do, but particularly I want to get involved in the op shop here. So I've committed to one day a week there, and really looking forward to that. I think that that's a wonderful outreach ministry of the church, and full of lots of potential and possibilities. That's exciting for me. And the rest I leave in the Lord's hands. He knows, and I trust Him, whatever that may be.
Good on you.
And for me, it's I've been the secretary of the church for about 4 years, and I feel really called to focus on that. And we're just fortunate and blessed that the Lord's put us in a place where I'm able to leave paid employee. And really looking forward to the next stage of our journey, but also to being able to contribute to the administration and of Reedy Creek Baptist Church.
I want to say thank you very much for what you both contribute to the life of this church, and also to the school as well. We thoroughly appreciate what you're doing, and God bless you in your new normal.
Thanks, David.
Thanks, David.
Thank you.
We are going through a series called Roadmap to Renewal. as the Australian and state governments roll out their roadmaps to recovery, many are wondering, and even hopeful, of a new normal. During the lockdown, many appreciated the time to regroup with family, not running around, travelling to work and to school. And so many are asking, what will my new normal be like? And we've been saying that in the Bible, God is into new things and gave many examples of how he renewed things like the new covenant between himself and all people, with Jesus being the mediator of the new covenant. And we looked at God's promises of new things to come, like the new heavens and earth in those last days. As many are looking for a new normal, we also shared that godly renewal is more than just decluttering and seeking a sea change. It's a lot deeper, with lasting fulfillment. And this series is looking at biblical principles to help us discover and sustain a new normal. The first principle is to have heaven as your destination. As we travel in life, eternity with God needs to be your destination. And repentance, faith, and obedience in Jesus Christ is the only way to eternity. That is the first principle. Set eternity with God as your destination. The second principle is to travel resolutely. Just as Joshua and his family resolutely set out to follow God in the new promised land, and also with Jesus, who resolutely set out to go into Jerusalem where he would complete his mission of dying for our redemption, so too do we need to travel on the narrow road resolutely. The third principle is to travel lightly. Last week, Robbie reminded us that we all carry loads of stuff, anxiety and resentment and unforgiveness, concerns for our children, our marriage, our future. To travel lightly and resolutely towards our destination, we are to cast these heavy issues onto Jesus, who promises to lighten our load. Today we are looking at the fourth principle, and that is to travel together. It's easy to do life on our own thinking that we don't need any help, but you will not travel as well by yourself. You know, God has ordained people to come into your life to strengthen you, to encourage you, to push you towards your purpose and your destiny. You see, birds that fly in formation, like when geese make the V, it takes 40% less energy for them to fly. They could do it by themselves, but they understand this principle that they won't go as far if they fly solo. Over 60 times in the New Testament, it says one another. Love one another, encourage one another, serve one another, comfort one another. You need one another around you. Don't isolate and think that I'm strong enough, I'm tough enough, I'm gifted enough. You may be what you have in mind, but not what God has in mind. He has something bigger, something more rewarding that you can't do simply by yourself. Are you flying solo? Or do you have people of faith flying with you, watching over you, praying for you? You can be good by yourself, but you can't be great by yourself. You won't travel as well without the right people around you. You can go 60%, but when you get in formation, when you have the family of faith blocking for you, praying for you and encouraging you, you'll go a further 40%. The early church has taught us how to travel the narrow road well. Oh, they weren't a perfect church, as they had their issues. But it's how they worked through these issues and other challenges that enabled them to go further with God's help. And some of the challenges they faced was that they were new in the Christian faith. They were in the minority in the towns in which they lived, and they often faced hardships and persecution. And so what did they do? Well, Acts 2 tells us how they travelled well together. And in Acts chapter 2, we read in verse 44, all the believers were together and had everything in common. And look down in verse 46, every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts. If you have your Bibles open, highlight the word together. Three times in these two verses, the word together is used. Together, these young Christians were traveling on this new road to eternity together. And together they worshipped, received teaching, had communion, prayed, fellowshiped, and served each other practically and evangelized the lost. They did all this together. In other passages throughout the book of Acts, we read that together they practically helped the widows, met to discuss concerning issues, gave to the poor, sent off missionaries and planted churches. I don't read of people flying solo in the book of Acts. There is great strength in traveling together. I guess that's what Solomon was thinking when he wrote in Ecclesiastes chapter 4 verse 12, though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves. A cord of three strands is not quickly broken. This passage, which is often read or referred to at Christian weddings, isn't really referring to marriages. In its context, Solomon is referring to teamwork. When teams work together with a common cause, great impact can be achieved. This was certainly the case with the new and early Christians. For we're told that when they worshipped and fellowshipped and evangelized together, we read in verse 47, that the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. I mean, how wonderful. During the recent lockdown, it was great to see various churches and Christian organizations working together. In our immediate community, so many from Reedy gave money and food to our Reedy Care. Karen then organized people to purchase food and other items when at the time, if you remember, there was a limit on what you could get. Another team of you got free bags from Rod Bates' office that were used to pack food for those in need. While all of this was happening, a community group with special government permission cooked thousands of pre-made meals and gave them to the community groups like churches. One such church was Elevation at Reedy, who would then ring up Reedy Care and we would collect these meals and then distribute it to those in our church and community and our school who needed a little bit of encouragement. Money was also anonymously given to some people that we knew were doing it tough financially. Thank you to those of you, including other groups and churches that gave to the church and Reedy Care. But the story of working together doesn't end there. Karen then organised the Reedy Care team to pack many bags for the homeless, in which others of you drove down across the border to give to Agape, a wonderful ministry that serves the homeless. This wasn't about building our little empires. It was about supporting each other who support others better together. Working together in formation, so to speak, helps the work to go that extra 40%. The movie Remember the Titans is based on a true story of how an American college football team had to overcome racism by coming together and work as a team. The movie is a great example of leadership, humility, and what can be achieved when people come together. Considering what is happening in America and the world over the past few weeks, I think this is particularly powerful.
You look like a bunch of fifth grade sissies after a cat fight. You got anger, that's good. You're gonna need it, son. You got aggression, that's even better. You're gonna need that too. But any little two-year-old child can throw a fit. Football is about controlling that anger, harnessing that aggression into a team effort to achieve perfection. when you put that uniform on, that Titan uniform, you better come to work. I think you're nothing. Nothing but a pure waste of God-given talent. You don't listen to nobody, man. You can't run over everybody in this league, and every time you do, you leave one of your teammates hanging out to dry. What was that, Ray? Whatever it is, it ain't blocking.
Give me a break.
You want a break? I'll give you a break. Me and Julius want to
break. Wait a minute, just let him in.
Get to rev once, just one time. I swear to God, I'm going to hit you so hard by the time you come to. Ooh, boy, you're going to need a new haircut. You understand me? Let's play, fellas.
It's a great story of a team that came together and not only resulting in winning games, but it changed hearts and a culture in their town. When we come together, we can go further than flying solo. Something happens corporately that doesn't happen individually, which is why I think the writer of Hebrews wrote to those group of Christians who were also new in the faith and were also going through a rough time. And he said to the Christians there, "Let us not give up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing." Guess what? Just about every one of us hasn't been meeting together. All right, I know that that was forced on us, but I wonder how many have formed a new habit that will be hard to break when church services resume. When we come together as a body of believers, united in faith, something happens that you cannot get on your own. That is why King David wrote, "Let us exalt his name together." When we come together to exalt his name, there is power. Don't let watching services online become a substitute for actually coming together to worship. You need to be around a community of believers. I know it takes work, getting up on your day off, rounding up the kids. And when you come, come with an attitude of praise and wanting to learn. It's the same when people come together for prayer. We know what happened when the early church met in homes and they started praying together. And thank you to those of you in your life groups and at church who meet together and likewise pray. But I reckon when the entire church comes together in prayer, it goes a whole new level. You see, in Scripture, Jehoshaphat was considered a good king. He went out and he cleansed the country of Judah from idols. And then in his third year, he sent out his priests and Levites to teach the people about the mighty law of God. He enjoyed a great measure of peace and prosperity, and the blessing of God was certainly upon the people. But Jehoshaphat, he was far from perfect. For example, he entered an alliance with King Ahab, which had a negative impact upon his kingdom. However, the last significant event of his reign is recorded in 2 Chronicles chapter 20. The Moabites formed a great and powerful alliance with the surrounding nations, and they came together against Jehoshaphat, the king, and his people. They were filled with alarm, and so Jehoshaphat started seeking God in prayer. And then he told his people everywhere to start fasting. Then we are told in verse 4 that the people of Judah came together to seek help from the Lord. Indeed, they came from every town in Judah to seek him. Notice that they came together from every town to pray. They were fasting and praying together. Well, that very act of coming together in prayer went to the next level. The Spirit of the Lord came upon a Levite who got up in the assembly and said these powerful words. He said, "You will not have to fight this battle. Take up your positions, stand firm, and see the deliverance that the Lord will give you, Judah and Jerusalem. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. Go out to face them tomorrow, and the Lord will be with you." The next day came, and they stood firm in faith. For Jehoshaphat told them all in verse 20, "Have faith in the Lord your God, and you will be upheld. Have faith in his prophets, and you will be successful." And we are told how the battle wasn't theirs, but God's. God caused eternal conflicts amongst the other powerful alliances until they ganged up on each other and destroyed each other, and Judah was spared. The kingdom of Judah was never more prosperous than under his reign. At Reedy, we are having that special opportunity of calling all of our church members to fast and pray, and then to come together. On the day, Sunday, July 12th, following our last online service in its present format that morning, we are encouraging people to fast and pray. And then at 5 p.m., to come together at our church centre for the first time since March, where together we will seek the Lord. May we come from our differing suburbs and together show to God that we desire his blessings for the return in the following week with all of our ministries and our activities and then our services. On that day, let's not travel solo, but together. I want to finish with this challenge about who are you traveling with together? When the Israelites were wandering in the desert for 40 years, they experienced some difficult times. In Exodus chapter 17, the Israelites encountered their first opposition in the desert. The Amalekites, who were a group of nomadic raiders, attacked the people of Israel. While Joshua led the troops into battle, Moses, along with Aaron and Hur, watched the battle from a nearby hill. However, Exodus chapter 17, verse 11 says, "As long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning." Moses became tired, and so Aaron and Hur responded. In verse 12, we read, "When Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat on it. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side, one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset." And God again came through. In the next verse, verse 13, we read, "So Joshua overcame the Amalekites' army with the sword." Moses nor Joshua were flying solo. With others, together, they were in formation, and together with God, they went further. We all need those people in our life who helps to lift up our hands. whenever we come together for prayer, worship, and fellowship, others will be there lifting up your hands. But more than that, we ought to be there ready to lift someone else's hands by your presence, words of encouragement, and prayer. The roadmap to renewal has eternity with God as our destination, and we are to travel this narrow road resolutely and with less baggage, and we are to do so with others. We are better together. As you commence your new normal, don't travel solo, but with one another. Let's pray. Father God, thank you that as you have called us to travel on the narrow road resolutely, with heaven as our destination, that we aren't to do this by ourselves, but with one another. I pray, Father God, that you help us to travel this road with others. For this season of our lives, you have called us to be a part of Reedy Creek Baptist Church. And I pray, Father God, that together we will travel this road, Lord, that will help each other to lift up our arms, Lord. Oh, Father God, I pray for those now who are just feeling so tired. I pray that you'll bring people into their lives that they can help lift up their arms. And I pray for those, Lord, who have got strength and drive and a purpose and a destiny, that you'll help them to also to lift up other people's arms. Father God, as we're on this roadmap to renewal, would you please renew our lives, our enthusiasm, our drive as we head towards our destiny, which is eternity with God. Thanks for being with us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. And let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Yes, you did, Lord. Too mighty to save. So take me as you find me. All my fears of faith. Give my life to follow.
and conquer.